Good morning to everyone here present, those watching online. Welcome to the memorial service of Paul. It is 11:30, the 15th of May 2021, and we really just want to welcome each and every one of you that have arrived here to support the family. They need it in these trying times, as we all do, and I can know with deep in my heart how they feel about your support, because in these trying times, we need one another. Just a quick house rule. Within this venue, we have a bathroom facility for the men's, your left, my right, and directly behind us is there for the ladies, so you don't have to leave this venue if should you want to use a bathroom break there. Fanny, it is absolutely a difficult moment for the Charnock family, Prema, Nikita, Kyle, and the extended family. We are here in support of you. We believe that this is the beginning of new things in your life, a new season. But the memory of Paul will always be around. We know that. I want to share a scripture with us quickly before I open up in prayer and allow the proceedings to go forth. In the Gospel of John, chapter 11, verse 25 and 26, the Lord Jesus himself is speaking in this passage of scripture, and he says these very powerful words. He says, "I am the resurrection and the life. He who believes in me, though he may die, he shall live." Think about that for a moment. I am the resurrection and the life. He who believes in me, though he may die, he shall live. Verse 26, "And whoever lives and believes in me shall never die." What is he saying here? He's saying that in Christ, we will live forever in heaven. That is powerful, family. For those of you who are born again and know the Lord Jesus Christ as your personal Lord and Savior, this rings true to our hearts dearly. Let's just close our eyes and open up this platform to the Holy Spirit, who is the great comforter, who will comfort each and every one of us here today. So, Father, Abba Father, you are our precious Daddy. Today, Father, we lean on you. We put our hope and our trust, our hurts and our pain, Father, in you. You understand this pain. You understand death in its fullness. Why? Because you sent your Son Jesus Christ to the cross for us, Lord. A man that had no sin went to lay his life down for each and every one of us here today and those online. Father, we trust in you and your great comforter, the Holy Spirit, who is within us, who gives us the power, the strength, and the ability to face the days and weeks, months and years to come. With you, Father, all things are possible. And Lord, as we go into the next days and few weeks, Father, we thank you for the family, the friends, those who are close, Lord, that they will continue to reach out to the family as they move into this new season of their life. Father, we thank you for the great support that they already have had, Lord. And we know this, Lord, that you do this through the love for each and every one of them, Prema, Nikita, and Kyle. Father, we worship you in advance for this in Jesus' mighty name. If you agree with that, just say amen. Amen. Well, family, we are gathered here today to pay our last respects to Paul. It is a privilege and an honor as a pastor of Christian Family Church, Pastor Bruce Rycroft, to officiate this wedding, this funeral service, as we really look into the life and resonate with the life that Paul had with each and every one of us. Because he's touched us in different ways, And he's really just given a piece of himself to each and every one of us so that we can hold on to that vivid memory in years to come. On behalf of Christian Family Church, the staff, the leadership, those involved, the membership of Christian Family Church, we extend our heartfelt condolences to the Charnock family. Losing Paul is absolutely a tremendous loss. As head of the home, as a breadwinner for the family, we know how significant a death can be to any family. I just want to encourage you once again that even in these trying times, there is one who is the great comforter. When everything is said and done, and we're all in our own homes, and we are reflecting on moments that we've cherished with Paul, there comes a time where you stand alone. But the Holy Spirit, who lives inside of us, can comfort us. Not with the comfort of the love of man, but the comfort of our Heavenly Father, the one who created you and I. He is the great comforter. So I want to encourage you, Prema, Nikita, and Kyle, no matter what you go through in the future, he is there. When Jesus left this earth, he said that he would leave us one like himself. As if Jesus is here with you today, that is the Holy Spirit. He is the perfect representation of a great comforter. We cannot receive God's fullness without him. And I want you to draw near to him in this trying time. When you are weak, he is your strength. When you do not have a decision made in your heart to go forward, he is your wisdom. I want you to lean on him like you would lean on Paul or somebody close to you. I want to encourage you with that this morning. Jesus said when he was preaching on the Mount of the Sermon, he said, "Blessed are those that mourn, for they shall be comforted." The word "shall" is not a maybe. It's not whenever you feel that you need him. He is constantly with you, 24/7. He understands your pain. He does. So I want to, once again, just encourage you to reach out to the Holy Spirit who is with you forever and ever. At this moment in time, I want to encourage us to stand as we just support the family and just come before the Lord as we sing a song that will just represent the fullness of who God is. And while we do this, let's just reflect on the memories that you've had with Paul. So let's stand to our feet, family. Praise the name of Jesus. In the valley, in the fire, you don't have to be afraid. He's continually with you. He will lead and guide you into all truth. That's our Father. Family of God, you may be seated. I trust you enjoyed that moment and were encouraged by that song and just reflected on the good life that you had together with Paul. We're going to call up the family right now to come and just share a few moments with us, some vivid memories. Participate. You know, there will be times where we can laugh. There will be times where it's going to hit home and it's going to be emotional. I want you to embrace that because we're emotional beings. We can laugh. We can weep. And really just resonate once again with the family's heart right now. So family, would you mind coming up?
Let me introduce myself first. My name is Dean, and I'm a friend of Paul's. When I got the call from, or the message from Prem on Monday morning, I mean, I think as we all were shocked, this can't be. You know, I'd spoken to my friend on Saturday. He'd got his appetite back and he was telling me how he was craving a bacon sandwich. And I sent him a photograph because that night I'd made, Paul and I loved our food, and I'd sent him a picture of this shabobo dish. And he was like, oh, it looks delicious, you know. He was... He wasn't going to die. So when the family, when Prem asked me to say something today, I really, really tried hard to sit down and write something. And I couldn't because I wanted my heart to speak today. You know, I met Paul as a supplier. And you know, if anybody knows Paul, he's a tough man. You know, he's a giving man, but you only find that out a little later. Once you get to know him, I mean, sorry, Lord, but my God, that guy could cut me out. You know, Paul didn't like tardiness. He was a perfectionist. He wanted everything to run smoothly. He wanted to be on time. He wanted our trucks to be on time. And I think we really got close one day when I surprised him when he, after a verbal beating, I just got in my car and I drove there. And I stood outside and waited while the truck arrived so that he could leave. And he didn't want to leave, he stayed. But you know, what was amazing about Paul was not only the fact that he could separate our friendship from business. I mean, we would have an altercation, he would shout and berate, and rightfully so. And then straight afterwards sit there and say, so did you watch the game on Sunday? You know, we were both avid and are avid Liverpool supporters. You know, we would sit for hours and talk about football, about politics, about his conspiracy theories around the US election. What a man. I think anybody, you know, he's one of those people that you meet that just become family, and I'm sure all those that are watching it at home, his work colleagues, Polyfloor, you know, Clive, Tandy, Denver, Renee, everybody there. I mean, I can't mention everybody, but the family, he's like family. And he certainly felt like family to me. you know, I'd often meet Paul and Premat when they'd have their hotel timeshare stints, and sometimes they would choose out in Hyde Park and an area where, so we're from the north. And, you know, the way he loved you was just incredible. You know, the way he loved his family and how supportive he was of his family, and how he boasted with pride and his chest swelled up when he spoke about his kids, Nikita and Carl. Just an incredible human being. And I'm very sad that I won't be able to see him again. He found out that I like cake. It's one of my guilty sins. I like cake a lot. And I didn't know that he could bake. So when he offered to make me a birthday cake, and I came to the office to fetch it. I didn't think that I'd receive a cake like that. It wasn't just the fact that the cake was amazingly glorious with, I mean, it was huge. It was a multi-tiered cake for my birthday, you know? With Ferrero Rochers and Whispers and this, I mean, chocolate, like Willy Wonka and the Chocolate Factory type stuff. And for me, I got a little teary at the time, because I understood the amount of effort that it must have taken for this man to make that for me, and how much he must have cared for me to do that. That was Paul. Everything he does, everything he did was 100%. You know, everything, whether it be work, whether it be love, whether it be courageous, whether it be cucking you out, he did it 100%. And he was an all or nothing guy. Black and white. There was no gray area with Paul. It was either right or it was wrong. And he was just phenomenal. And the world was certainly a sadder place without him in it. And I will certainly miss him. Thank you.
Where do I even begin? Let me start with thanking you all for being here with us today. Your support has been amazing, and we are so blessed to have every single one of you in our lives. My dad was the most incredible man I knew. His happiness came from the happiness of others. He was thoughtful, loving, and always put others first. I'm going to miss his warm hugs and delicious chocolate cakes. I feel so grateful to have had him in my life. And even though he's not here with me in person, I know he is smiling down on me. I will continue to make him proud every chance I have. I love you forever and always, Dad, until we meet again.
I'm just going to read a short message from someone who couldn't make it on the PowerPoint, from Visaka. To Paul, the world's greatest husband and dad, son and son-in-law, brother, and to all of us, a special friend that we knew. You're an amazing human being, kind, caring. We were blessed knowing you. We thank God for you being in our lives. I'm getting blinded by my tears now. Thank you for the special memories we spend together, and that will always be in our hearts. We don't say goodbye. We say see you later, brother. We send you with all our love and prayers, and may your precious soul rest in peace, Paul. Now for mine. As you know, I'm a man of very few words, so where do I begin? My dad, the king of sticking his tongue out in pictures. I can guarantee you most of us have at least one of these on our phones. Let's just say my dad was a decisive character, but he loved wholeheartedly and unconditionally. He would take on mountains for the ones he loved and was always at his happiest surrounded by his friends and family. He was a man of integrity, honor, and strong will. But most importantly, he was a fantastic father and man. If I can live up to even 10% of the man he was, then what a great man I would have become. Not to mention, I'd probably be quite the trivia whiz too. Along with my mother, they have both provided me and my sister the greatest platform to become great human beings. I vowed to make him proud of the man he raised. And the last thing I want to say, that I regret not saying more, is I love you, Dad, my golden angel.
Hi, everybody. I just want to say thank you so much for everybody coming today, and for those of you that are watching via live stream, I really appreciate your being here to honor Paul. Where do I start? Everyone kept asking me this week, where do I get my strength from? How can I be so strong? I can unequivocally say that it's from the one and the only, our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, whose name I hold high and I glorify, because we couldn't do this without him. Paul was an amazing man. He was undoubtedly my biggest cheerleader in life, and I owe everything to him. I could not have accomplished anything I've accomplished without his support. He derived his happiness from mine and the kids' happiness, and from his friends and family. Those who knew him know that Paul was a simple, down-to-earth, honest man. He had no airs and flares about him, and you could take him by his word. He was affectionate, caring, loving, and what you saw is what you got. He didn't mince his words. There's simply no hidden agendas with Paul. There are people that play games Paul didn't. Paul was fiercely protective, for those of you that know him well, loving and loyal to those he cared for. When it came to his work, Paul loved his job. When he couldn't go in, he'd be miserable. The people that he worked with was not just his work colleagues, it was his family. He had a work ethic beyond belief. And he always said that if something cannot be done in an exemplary manner, it wasn't worth doing. He never minced his words with people, so you always knew where you stood with Paul. Mom, I know that you're in England, and this is a tough time for you. But know that Paul loved and appreciated you beyond belief. He loved his siblings and his family in the UK and would always check over them, even though you may not always have known that he loved you. My brothers and my sisters and my family was his family. The bond that he had with my brothers and sisters and his brother-in-laws was unbelievable and unbreakable. He loved them so dearly, and Paul loved deeply. Everyone knew him for his exceptional baking skills, which he got from his nan, and the pleasure I would see in his face when people would enjoy his baking was incredible. That's all he wanted. People would say, "Can you bake me a cake and I'd pay you for it?" It was not about that. He wanted to just please people. Paul's knowledge of everything from sport to politics to news to general knowledge was unbelievable. I used to say he was my walking encyclopedia. You didn't stand a chance with him in any trivia or quiz game. Nikita and I were in the car the other day with Kyle, and Nikita said to me, "Mom, where was I born?" And I had to think about it twice, because I never actually chose to remember things, because Paul's memory was beyond belief. If he was in the car with us, he would have said, "Oh, Nikita, you were born such and such, and it was this time, and you weighed this, and this was showing on the TV." He'd have the eye for all the details. So I never had to remember stuff. Everyone knew him for his love of football, and he was a typical diehard Liverpool fan to the end. The other day, Marty phoned me, and we were chatting, and he was talking about Paul with his shopping. I didn't do shopping. I'd go to any shop and buy anything. Paul would go through every advertisement and look for all the specials, and then he'd phone all his friends and family that he knew was looking for something and tell them about the specials, not just keep it to himself. Those little details, I don't know, there's not many people like that. This was a giant of a man. The legacy he leaves is unbelievable. He gave me all the love in the world. He gave me two beautiful children and a lifetime of wonderful memories. Lastly, to my darling babes, I suppose I wanted to spend the rest of my life with you, but then realized that you spent the rest of your life with me. I smile because I know you loved me till the day you went away, and will keep loving me till the day we meet together, be together again. Thank you for the memories, our gorgeous children, and the joy you brought to my life. And I will love you till my last breath, till we meet again, my love.
Losh, my sister, We just did not see this coming. How does someone whose footprints left endearing markings, whose voice of reason put things into a clearer perspective, whose workmanship was undeniable in its precision, whose laughter echoed resoundingly throughout our homes, whose love for you knew, whose commitment to family knew no bounds. How do we fill that void, sis? Paul, my brother, you are irreplaceable in our family, and you've enriched us more. Nikki, Kyle, Nan, our hearts ache for you all. If we could, we would bring a day when your happy memories of Paul are stronger than your sadness from his passing. Although far, we are here for you any time of the day or night. We hope that with every day that passes, your pain diminishes slightly, but we know your love for him will never dim. Paul, we will miss you so much, your big brotherly protectiveness, your jokes, your advice, your love. Paul, when he loved, loved wholeheartedly. He would drop anything to help you, to be there for you. He did not hold back his love. He would tell you straight what he thought. Like it or not, he held back no punches, but it was his way to show you that he cared dearly. I must add, I was Paul's favorite, or at least I'd like to think so. He would do anything for me. Of course, it came with the pros and cons. I got an endless supply of minstrels, our personal private family joke. Paul, the truth is, although I told you I took your last packet, I actually took the fall for it, as we all knew I would get away with it. He would, on the other hand, give me the longest lectures when I was out of line, but I knew it was because he really cared about me. He once chased me around the resort when he saw me get up to mischief. I gave back as much as he gave me. I was one of the few people that could tell him off, and he would still talk to me afterwards. Paul brought a very different element to our family. He taught us how to stand up for ourselves, be more structured, live in the moment. Although he tried hard to teach us to be on time, the Ramyas couldn't quite get that right. He was a typical old-fashioned, stick-by-the-book kind of guy. He even came home to ask Losha's hand in marriage. Amma, our granny, loved him to bits, and believe me, she was romantic, used to swoon my sis with the best presents, and never felt afraid to show her his love. He was sentimental and remembered every date, birthdays, anniversaries, and special dates. He was our walking calendar and hoarded memories. You could not dare to get rid of his things. Paul was meticulous in everything he did. It could be seen in his work. He was loyal, dedicated, and he treated his work like it was his own. Paul was knowledgeable about everything. If you ask him about any general knowledge question, he would answer you like Wikipedia. We all knew never to argue with him about soccer, especially Liverpool. You will lose sorely. I will surely miss our fights. Kitara was also one of his favorites. He loved fighting with her. That was her smackabums. Not really sure who was smackabums, as they called each other the same name. From the Mupamars, Kumari, she sent a special message. When I said I wanted to say two things from the Mupanar family side, I didn't realize how hard it would be. How do I put 20-odd years of such special memories into two sentences? Feels impossible. When we think of Paul, what comes to mind is his blushy smile, huge heart, and hugs. Our holiday memories and the way he always spoke his mind. Always in our heart, forever, Polycans. Nikki, Losh, Nan, Kyle, know that we are all here for you guys always. Paul, a dear brother, loving dad, amazing husband, loving son, dedicated employee, best friend. We bid you farewell, my brother.
Good morning, everyone. On behalf of the Governor, Ramya, Punar, Naidu, and Charnock family, I would like to thank you for joining us, saying goodbye to a husband, father, brother-in-law, friend, and let's not forget the best baker ever, Paul. So before I start, I would like to take a minute of silence and prayerization across the planet during this pandemic. Thank you. Paul is a man that has shown that to get to know someone, you have to put the time to find out what their likes and dislikes are and what their passions, learn about it. And if you don't know anything about it, you should always be able to find a common ground to build a relationship on. And he knew a lot about everything. That's why I used to call him Mr. Encyclopedia. I remember the first time we met. He looked at me and said, if you want to be in this family, make sure you got Amma on your side. That's the type of person he was. Willing to help when he just met me. As it goes, a journey of 1,000 miles begins with the first step. As the same goes, your journey in life starts with all people that you meet along the way. Paul is one of those special people we met along our journey of life, who's not perfect, but I'm working on it. Loved everything he did with passion, and you don't see that in everyone, but can't help to aspire to be more like him. He always wore his heart on his sleeve and was very proud of that. As we deal with the loss, he would want us to be sad, but just for a bit, but rather remember the good times and the memories and the moments we shared with him. To Losh, Nikki, Kyle, and Nan, Kathy, Paul is with you when you are sad. He is with you when you feel down and lonely, and he is with you, guiding you through every step. And when you need him the most, you will feel his presence. And in this way, he knows you will never walk alone. And to us, we cherish the memories we shared till the end of time, and you will always be in our heart. Thank you for joining us.
We are praying that God's love enfolds you and comforts you through your pain. Know that Paul's soul is up in heaven and you will be reunited with him again one day in the future. I pray God gives you comfort and strength during this difficult time. Nothing I can say I know can change what happened, but we are here for you, Losh, and the kids, Kyle and Nikki, during the time of your loss. I want to just share John 14, verse 27. Peace I leave with you. My peace I give to you. Not as the world gives do I give to you. Let not your hearts be troubled, neither let them. We love you, Losh, Kyle, and Nikki. God bless you.
Paul was my sports guru. Whenever we met, we shared long conversations, which always included many sporting codes, but most especially soccer and his beloved Liverpool. Other than his impeccable memory to quote records offhand and factual sport telling, Paul always had time for my family, be it a stopover in Jersey, on a trip overseas, for accommodating us for a short holiday. His love and genuine hospitality will always be remembered. A wonderful soul who will sorely be missed by us all. May his soul rest in peace. Tosh and family.
On Sunday, we lost not only a colleague and integral member of the Polyfloor team, but a friend and member of our family. Paul came to work at Polyfloor temporarily 15 years ago and never left. His passion for Polyfloor was clear for anyone to see, and his love for his job shone every day. Yes, Paul could be stern or even gruff at times, but his bark was way worse than his bite. His directness always came from a place of doing what he thought was best for Polyfloor and his warehouse team. Under that sometimes tough exterior was a heart of gold, and if ever his guys needed help, Paul was there to give it. He was always ready to defend our team, to give a kind word or assist when truly needed. Paul was a man of his convictions, and he stood by them with solid belief. He brought a different perspective to many team and strategic discussions, and we shall miss his input dearly. Paul was not easily swayed, and it took a solid set of facts and thorough discussion to change Paul's mind or perspective, and I very much admired that for him. He grew as a leader in our business in leaps and bounds. Paul was always willing to learn, to try, and to do what it took to make Polyfloor more successful. Over the last 18 months and through the COVID crisis, Paul never gave up. No matter what he had to do to make it happen, stock came in and stock went out. Right until his last minute, he was ensuring things ran smoothly. Paul, my friend, your blood runs green. Your loyalty, passion and dedication to Polyfloor will always be remembered and always appreciated. The many people we have spoken to or received messages from in the last few days all admired and respected Paul. They knew where they stood with him and the level of service they could expect from him, or that he expected from them. He was truly a special member of our team. Thank you for the outpouring of wishes. We really do appreciate them. At Polyfloor, we are not just a team, but a family. We take time to have fun, enjoy one another's company, laugh, and eat. Oh yes, we are lovers of food. It is rumored you gain 10 kilograms when you join Polyfloor. Paul was a magnificent baker and produced the most delicious cakes for many a birthday, an event, or even sometimes just because. I shall miss your cakes, my friend, and promise to keep up the baking tradition. He was also our braai master for Friday Burry Days, organizer of Kentucky Fridays in the warehouse, pizzas on the order desk, and ice for all our straight sessions. For us as the Coleman family, there was nothing Paul would not do. He would check we had firewood for cold days, gas, fetch and deliver numerous things that were not Polyfloor related. Paul and Prema became dear friends to the family, and all day Trump, vaccines, the best way to do this or that. I am so grateful you came to Polyfloor and was always touched by your extreme loyalty and buoyed by your personal support that you gave to me. I know the whole Polyfloor family is behind me here today as we bid you farewell. We will miss you dearly. We know we now have an angel in heaven to watch over and guide us. We promise you we will take care of Prema, Kyle, and Nikita. As always, they will be loved and supported by us all. As your beloved Liverpool would say, they will never walk alone. Goodbye, Paul.
This is one of the hardest things that I've ever had to do, and it's still so hard to believe. To say goodbye to my best friend Paul. I met Paul over 6 years ago and we connected immediately. He helped me through a lot and was always there for me. Paul had a strong personality and had the biggest of hearts, always trying to help. And as Charles would always say, in life's journey, we get people coming in and out of our lives, but only the special ones leave a mark. Paul was that special and unique person. He had a big impact in my life, and for that I will always be grateful. I'm very thankful to have had him as a part of my life. You will always be missed dearly, my friend, and may your soul rest in peace.
Unending love, amazing grace. You may be seated, family. To Dean and Prema, Nikita, Kyle, you guys did an amazing job up here. Well done. I think your dad would be really proud of you guys. Paul would be absolutely amazed by just sharing some of your heart and what meant, the impact that he meant in your life. So that's him in a nutshell, really. It's just hearing from the family, all the voice notes, the messages that came through. Now we have a clear picture. For those who do not know Paul as well as the family does, now we know, we have a clearer picture of who he was and the impact that he had on his family and his community. Family of God, I just want to spend a few moments with you just to share the Word of God with you. My dream and my heart here is to speak to your heart, not to your mind. If we look at the life of Paul Clifford, we know that he was not perfect. Neither one of us are perfect. But he had one thing going for him besides the goodness that he had on earth. And that is, he knew Jesus Christ and his personal Lord and Savior. That's imperative for any man's future and for any man's legacy. That's imperative. A service like this, a memorial service where we can just remember the good times with Paul, has really two purposes. The first, it's for us, those who are here mourning him, grieving the friendships, the love, the kindness, the individual who he was that impacted each and every one of us. That's why we're here, is to really just be with one another in this mourning period. And the second is absolutely a graduation, a celebration of his life. Everything that we've heard, all the voice notes, the messages, everything, the interaction that we've had outside of this moment has really all been about a celebration of a life that impacted each and every one of us in so many ways. And just for a moment, I want to ask you a question and find out, do you know the answer to this question? I want you to think about it. Is there life after death? Is there life after death? I'm sure we've all thought about it at one point in our life, maybe multiple times. But let's just go to Scripture, the truth of God's Word, to find out, is there life after death? And I want to share with you from John chapter 14, from verse 1 to 6. Once again, Jesus himself is talking in this portion of Scripture, and he says these words, "Do not let your hearts be troubled. Believe in God, believe also in me. My Father's house has many mansions. If that were not so, I would have told you that I am going there to prepare a place for you. And if you go and prepare a place for you, I will come back and take you to be where I am, so that I can be with you. You know the way to the place where I am going," he says to his disciples. But Thomas, one of the disciples, said, "Lord, we do not know where you are going, so how can we know the way?" And I want to say this to you today. Jesus answers this, and he's speaking to you and I today, and he says these words, "I am the way, I am the truth, and I am the life. No one comes to the Father except through me." Paul could not know his heavenly Father if he didn't go through Jesus Christ. Jesus says he is the way. There is no alternative way. There is no other way. He is the way. In this portion of Scripture, the Father's heart springs forth at each and every one of us here today. And the fact is that he says that we should not be troubled when we die. He's talking to believers here. We should not be troubled when we die. He goes on to say that he himself prepares the place so that when we die, we have a home, we have a mansion in his great kingdom. Then he goes on to say, he himself will come back and fetch you. Now that's the heart of a father as we know it. A father wants to care for his children. A father wants to care for the ones that he has laid his life down for. This is powerful, family. So it answers the question, is there life after death? Absolutely. If you know the Heavenly Father, if you know Jesus Christ as your personal Lord and Savior, then you will end up in heaven where your Father is, the one who created you. Another question I want to ask you, and just to, I want you to resonate once again with us. What happens to us after we die? What has happened to Paul after he had breathed his last breath on earth? Have you given that some thought? Once again, we turn to Scripture to gain clarity so that it's not your perception or my perception. It's the truth. Once again, Luke chapter 16 really brings this across quite evidently. And the Scripture says that there was a certain rich man, Jesus said, who was splendidly clothed and lived each day in luxury and myrrh. So he was a successful man. One day Lazarus, a diseased beggar, was laid at his door. As he lay there longing for the scraps of the rich man's table, the dogs would come and lick his open sores. Finally, the beggar died and was carried by the angels to Abraham in the place where the righteous dead exist. The rich man also died and was buried. And his soul went into hell. There in torment, he saw Lazarus at the far distance with Abraham. Father Abraham, he shouted, have some pity. Send Lazarus, because he knew Lazarus. Send Lazarus over here, if only to dip his finger in water and cool my tongue. For I am in anguish in these flames. But Abraham said to him, son, remember that during your lifetime you had everything you wanted and Lazarus had nothing. So now he is here being comforted and you are there in anguish. And besides, there is a great chasm separating us and no one wanting to come to you is stopped at its edge. And anyone wanting to cross over is once again stopped at its edge. The rich man said, oh, Father Abraham, please send somebody from my father's house. For I have five brothers to warn them about this place of torment, lest they come here and die. But Abraham said, the scriptures have warned them again and again. Your brothers can read them at any time they want to. The rich man replied, no, Father Abraham, they won't bother to read them. But if someone is sent from the dead, then they will turn from their sins. But Abraham said, they won't even listen to Moses and the prophets. They won't listen even to someone who rises from the dead. This is powerful, family of God. As I stand here today before you, I'm sent by God to give you the undiluted word of God. That's what I'm here to do. God is speaking to each and every one of your hearts. I know this. I know this. But this particular scripture must ring true to you. Because what happens to you after you die? We know that Paul is with his father, the one who created him. We know this. He was a member of Christian Family Church. He knew the Lord. He made decisions. There were discussions about religion amongst each and every one of us here. I'm sure of it. But in this portion of Scripture, family of God, I want to draw your attention to hell. Hell is not a place where it just stinks and it's dead and there's nothing happening and there's people that have no hope. It's much more than that. In this portion of Scripture, we can hear the rich man say that where he is, there is anguish. I don't know if we grasp the revelation of the word anguish. Have you ever been in anguish? Perhaps you've been through a horrific incident or an accident in your life, and you were in deep, deep pain. That happens in hell 24/7. It's not something we can overlook. It's not something that we want to overlook. The rich man goes on to say that there where he is, it's constant torment. I can only bring some kind of analogy to this by a young woman or a young man being tormented by somebody older, and they have no authority, they have no strength to fend off themselves. That's what brings home for me. But torment, once again, is constant violation of yourself in various different ways. This is not something, family of God, that we can take lightly. I don't believe any one of us here sitting today would want to be in a place where anguish and torment is our future for eternity. I'm not talking about whether you live to be 50, 70, or 90. It's for eternity. There is no end to the anguish and the torment, family of God. I'm confident, I have peace in my heart, that Paul is in a better place. I know this. Because if you know Jesus Christ as your personal Lord and Savior, He welcomes you in. He knows your name. Once again, family, death comes like a thief in the night, Dean. We never know when this happens. It's not asking you whether you're ill or whether you're healthy, whether you're black or whether you're white, whether you're rich or whether you're poor. Death comes like a thief in the night, totally unexpected. So we have to be ready for that moment when we breathe our last, because when we breathe our last, immediately we are present with the Lord. Decision time. Family of God, if you had any kind of relationship with Paul, I want you to reflect back on the discussions that you've had. When he tried to talk to you about religion or God or scripture, anything in that line, that was the Lord using him to impact your life. That's the way the Lord Jesus Christ works. He uses each and every one of us to tell us that there is a heaven and that there is a hell and there's nothing in between. I'm not asking you if you grew up in a Christian home. I'm not asking you if you do more good than bad in life. I'm not even asking you if you are in church. It's not what I'm asking you. I'm asking you, do you have a personal relationship with God? Do you know Him? Not of Him, but do you know Him? When He speaks to you, can you hear His voice? Do you know Him? The only way we can know Him is read His word. Be amongst people who celebrate Him. Be amongst the brethren. Family of God, I know that I'm touching your heart right now. And I want you to make a quality decision. Today is about a quality decision. Otherwise, I would not be able to stand up here and say, He's in heaven. I wouldn't do that, number one. Number two is I want to reassure you that you have the perfect opportunity. Today is the day of salvation. You might think, but Pastor Bruce, I have a whole lifetime ahead of me. Many of us do. Many of us fail when we don't achieve that lifetime. Family of God, I want you to look into your heart right now. You're not perfect. We know this. I'm not perfect. But that's why Jesus Christ says that His mercy is on you every day. His grace is sufficient for you and I. It's not about works. It's about His grace. Nothing you can do or say can get you into heaven. It is absolutely God's grace. Ephesians 2 says this. For it is by grace that you've been saved through faith. And it's not from yourselves. It's a gift of God. Receive that gift here today. Don't leave this premises knowing that you will not make it to hell or heaven. Either one is for eternity. You might say, Pastor Bruce, how do I do this? Once again, the scriptures are very clear in John chapter 3, verse 3 and 26. Jesus answered and said to him, "Most assuredly I say to you, unless one is born again, you cannot see the kingdom of heaven." What does it mean to be born again? You have to believe that Jesus Christ is the Son of the everlasting God. You need to believe this. You need to confess with your mouth that He is the Lord of Lords. You have to do this to receive His fullness. Once you say this with a heart of gratitude, His Spirit enters into your spirit and enlightens your spirit. New things begin to form in your heart that you've never experienced before. It can only come by receiving Jesus Christ in His fullness in your heart. If you confess with your mouth and believe in your heart that God was raised from the dead, you will be saved. Thereafter, God will lead and guide you by His Spirit to do certain things you would never have done before. Can I ask you just to close your eyes and bow your heads for a moment? This is a moment between you and God. Nobody's looking around. Nobody's going to judge you. I'm not going to ask you to do something that is out of your comfort zone. I want you to make a decision in your heart. And I'm going to give you an opportunity to confess with your mouth that He is your Lord. That you want Him to forgive you of all your sin. No matter how great you might think your sin is. No matter how dirty it may be. God is a forgiving God. His mercy makes it possible. His grace welcomes you in. So family of God, if you say, Pastor Bruce, I'd like you to pray with me. And I'm going to ask everyone to pray this prayer with you, to come into agreement with you. Say, Pastor Bruce, I need Jesus. I've backslidden. I'm not where I should be with my Heavenly Father. I want you to pray with me, Pastor Bruce. Just quickly, while eyes are closed, heads are bowed, just quickly raise your hand so that the Heavenly Father can see it. Praise you. Thank you, Father. Those online, there where you are sitting right now at home, if you want to make this decision, this is the time to do it. God sees your hand. God sees your heart. Be sure, family, this morning, this afternoon, that you have a right relationship and that you will go to heaven. Matthew chapter 10, verse 33 says, "But whoever denies me before men, him will I also deny before my Father who is in heaven." Don't let this moment go by. Raise your hand and say, "Pastor Bruce, quickly, that's me. I put up my hand. I'm dropping it right down again. I want to be recognized." Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Father. While heads are bowed and eyes are closed, if that was you, I want you to pray this prayer with me. And we're going to ask everyone just to say it along in support of your decision right here today. Say this. Say, "Dear Heavenly Father, I come before you in Jesus' name. I confess that I'm a sinner. I repent of all my sin, Father. Forgive me. I want to spend my time with you in eternity. I confess with my mouth that you believe in my heart, new life. Your word says that that I'm in right standing with you when I say this. I believe in my heart that I'm born again. I'm a child of God. Should I die today, I would go straight to heaven. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. You can look up again. Family, thank you for this opportunity just to share the word with you. If you made a decision in your heart to pursue Jesus Christ, the first step that you need to take is you need to invest into a church that is growing. Why? Because Jesus and his bride, the church, are one. You need to invest and put your roots down so that you can grow in Christ, so that it can lead you into all truth. Find a church, family of God, a church that will help you on your journey. Don't do this alone. You are not made for it. Amen. Amen. Well, just in a closing statement, we just want to thank each and every one of you once again for this great opportunity to come into support with the family, share your love with them. There's just a note that they would just like to extend to each and every one of you. Family and friends, thank you for coming to this. To those who couldn't be here, we appreciate your love and your care via the voice notes, the messages that come through. The family really receive this with a loving heart. Those viewing virtually, thank you for participating and everything that you do for the family. In support to the friends and the family and the church as a whole, they want to say thank you to everyone that made this day possible. A special thanks to Denver, Sheila, Tandy, and the Polyfloor family as a whole. The love and support that you've had is unbelievable. It's grateful to their hearts. Leroy, Bronny, I know that you can't be here, but you guys have been such a pillar of love and support. We value you. To my close family and friends in Johannesburg who care for us, who call us, who support us, it's very touching to this family in this trying time. To the church, Christian Family Church as a whole, they thank the team, the guys at the back at the sound desk, the guys that prepared everything, the venue and everything, the facility itself, making it available. They also want to say thank you to all the people that contributed. The social media encouragement, the love for each and every one of you that have gone out. They really value it. And then finally, a reminder to everyone for the address of the Grove Garden Coffee Shop, where refreshments will now be served straight after the service as we conclude and as I can play. Join them at the coffee shop so that you can just once again share your love with them and support for them. Let's stand to our feet as we close this service. And we give God all the praise for what he has done here today in people's hearts. Once again, Father, we thank you for your goodness and your mercy that goes before us, Lord. We deserve nothing, but because of your mercy and your grace, Father, we are able to face each day, Father, with the strength that can only come from